It's a real honor for me personally and for us at the Price School to welcome an old friend and colleague, Professor Storper. I think his work speaks for himself, but I've always felt that perhaps reflecting the fact that he spends half his time in Europe and half his time in North America sort of combines different scholarly traditions. There's a kind of grand narrative one associates maybe more with the European literature and in a sense almost a kind of post-Marxian, as I say, kind of grand narrative, but at the same time a very kind of satisfyingly rigorous approach and attention to detail and the logical flow of an argument, I think, is attended to with great rigor, I think, is a way of characterizing very much of his work, and I think that's widely recognized, which is one of the reasons that this book and other work is attracting much attention. We're also very delighted that the discussant for this presentation is our own Professor Elizabeth Currid, recently appointed, as many of you know, to the James Irvine Chair in Urban and Regional Planning, which is a high honor, and we're really delighted that she will be commenting on his presentation. So just so you all know, we do want, after the presentation, the comments, there will be some Q&A. I will have to cut it off at 1:30 because we have to get our guests over to lunch before they close up. So forgive us when we dash out of here. So with that introduction out of the way, I'd like to turn it over to Professor Storper.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Thank you all for being here. I'm honored to be invited across town. And also thanks for the characterization of my work, which is one I agree with. I really like that idea of trying to have a big story, but trying to make the story come together with all the building blocks rigorous, not, as it were, made up. So I want to point out the book is prettier in reality. In case you want to buy it, it's prettier than that horrible slide. It bleached all the color out. And what I'm going to do, because I always prepare too much material, in order to try and respect the time that's given to me, is I'm going to soundbite some slides rather than give you all the depth, because I want you to see sort of the broad argument and how the pieces fit together. So let me just start out by saying, why did we do this book? It's about LA and San Francisco, so it has a local interest, but actually we like to think that it fits into a broader problem when we think about cities and regions today, which is this. Cities and regions, the economy does two things to them. On the one side, there are forces that make them more similar in their level of economic development. That's called convergence in the regional and urban economics literature. But there are also forces that pull them apart and make some cities richer and poorer. And divergence is very important when you find it. On the ground, it's very important because if you're on the bad side of divergence, meaning you're not the winner city and region, what happens is you have living standards that are lower than the places that are at the top. And the other thing that you have is a whole set of things that come from having lower living standards. For example, because your economic performance determines a lot of your tax receipts, it determines the fiscal capacities of your governments to spend on good things like culture and infrastructure and housing and social services and a whole bunch of other things. And I'll give you the headline here right now. In Southern California, we spend a lot more per head on all of these good things now. We spend $18,000 per person in metropolitan Southern California. The Bay Area spends $25,000 per person in its discretionary spending. That's what divergence has done to us. So here's the broader context. If you look back to 1970, there was a narrow band. This is just a very select group of highly performing metropolitan areas and also ones that are more than 2 million people. If I gave you a slide of the whole metropolitan system, you'd see income spread out between the lowest, meaning Brownsville, Texas, which has a per capita income of $23,000 a year, and the highest, San Francisco, with a per capita income of $78,000 per year. That's bigger than differences between what we call high and middle income countries, but it's within the same country. So convergence forces are not fully in operation here in the United States. We have a lot of different levels of economic development between cities. But most importantly, we are in a divergence period. We're in a divergence period roughly since the 70s are kind of the very beginning of it, but the 80s it really gets going. And the significance of that is that in the 70s and 80s, we go into what we now recognize as the new economy. It's a kind of economy. It's based on sectors. It's based on processes that are different from the middle of the 20th century when forces were out there. There were dominant industries like manufacturing. Now we're in a post-manufacturing world here in the U.S. And what this has done to cities and regions is make the process of economic development change toward more divergence. It's not unique to America. If you look at other developed countries like the UK or France, you see the same result. So the new economy reversed the trends toward convergence between metropolitan regions that we observed in the middle decades of the 20th century, and the world we live in is one of divergence. More generally, we could say metropolitan regions, first of all, they're growing relative to other places. They're growing faster than their respective national economies. So cities are where the action is today, city regions especially. They're getting richer. That is, the gaps between the biggest metropolitan regions, their average level of economic development, and the national economy are growing. Cities are richer. And they are also then again diverging among themselves. So it's not a phenomenon where all cities have the same outcome. So they're not only getting a wider spread between the best or most highly performing city regions and the less well-performing ones, but in addition, there's what we might call turbulence. This is a harder one to grasp. What we mean is that from one period to another, it's not possible to predict which of the cities end up on top and which don't. So what there's been is this kind of shifting up and down within the basic story of divergence. So this is very important because it really changes the fundamental background conditions that we need to look at when we understand cities and regions as an urban system relative to the overall process by which the national economy functions. This is the world we're in. Richer, growing cities, more divergence, more turbulence. That's what seems to be the reality today. So we took on LA and San Francisco as a test case. We wanted to see what happens to determine in light of this basic picture, what happens to two specific cities? And we thought that was an ideal test case for what you're going to see in a second. First of all, when I say LA and San Francisco, I mean the entire metropolitan functional urban regions. That means our five-county region here with 17.8 million residents, and up to 2012 census, what was the 10-county San Francisco Bay Area, it's now 12. Because all the commuting areas got it added in. But these are two integrated regional economies. I'm not talking about the city of San Francisco or Silicon Valley or LA County, but the whole thing. So here's the story. In 1970, at the end of that 20th century pattern of economic growth, LA and San Francisco were basically identical in terms of their economic development level. They had a 4% difference in per capita income. Today, that difference is 1/3. Now, put this against the background of LA in the 20th century. In the early 20th century, Southern California is smaller and poorer than the Bay Area. It's the latecomer. It's the catch-up kid. And what happens is, during the first two-thirds of the 20th century, LA is the economic development miracle of the United States and almost, in fact, the entire developed world. LA multiplies its population 21 times over in the first two-thirds of the 20th century and does it with high-quality growth. What I mean by that is millions of people come into this region, and at the same time, the region moves up the ranks of per capita income to join the very elite club of the top five metropolitan regions in terms of wealth per capita in 1970. It's bigger and richer, or what we would call good quality growth, or opportunity-based growth. But this is what happens to us. We get there and then it reverses, meaning we get right up, we're like right on the kind of like right on the tail of the Bay Area, and then the Bay Area takes off and we fall behind. That's the one-third difference. Most shockingly, San Francisco was the wealthiest American metropolitan region in 1970. It still is. But LA fell from number 4 to number 25. And that's understating it, because all we're doing here is looking at metropolitan regions with more than 2 million people. If you put us in the context of all 337 metropolitan areas, we'd be 57 or 58 among them. Moreover, if I were to section out LA County, which has a per capita income of less than $30,000 a year, it would rank, and remember, LA County has 10 million people. It's bigger than all but a few entire metropolitan areas. It would rank 153rd in metropolitan regions in the United States. This is, in other words, the figures are dire. And notice what happens. So here, what you see is the first two columns is per capita income. We took the top 10 in 1970. And you'll notice the different fates. So the bad performers are, for example, LA, number 4 to number 25. People often forget today that Detroit was a very wealthy metropolitan region in 1970. It's now number 52. You'll notice another thing that's kind of interesting today is Boston isn't even in the top 10 in 1970, because Boston had tanked already by the late 1950s, because it was based on old industries like making textiles and clothes and shoes that moved to the South and caused its economy to tank very early. But Boston would now be in the top 5. Now, the other thing to look there is population, because that's the other variable you want to think about. Cities and regions, basically the two ways that you can think about their growth dynamics is, are they bringing in a lot of people or not, or even losing people, and what are they doing with their income, and how do the two combine? And what you see there is why our comparison is a pretty good one. Both San Francisco and LA lie pretty close to the US median in terms of population growth in this period. LA more, however. LA had 78% population growth. The Bay Area only had 58%. But they're both rapidly growing regions that take in millions of people in this period. What really differentiates the Bay Area and Southern California is income. The Bay Area takes in all these people and keeps incomes high. LA takes in all these people and doesn't keep incomes high. But you see other cases there. So New York and Boston, they do well on incomes. That's in the upper left of this diagram. But they're not rapidly growing. They're old cities on the East Coast. So what they're doing is well on income, but they're not particularly welcoming places. You take the lower left, which is the really bad scenario among our cities and here in the United States, and that is cities that don't do well on income or population. So they're neither extending opportunity, nor are they creating high opportunity. Then you have the upper right-hand quadrant where San Francisco is situated, as well as a few upcoming cities, mostly in a part of the South. And that is city regions that take in a lot of people and do well on income. We might say that the LA of the 21st century is Houston. Houston is a big, very wealthy city that is doing what LA did in the first two-thirds of the 20th century. And then on the lower right, what you have is actually quite a vast range of our metropolitan regions that have a lot of population growth, but it's not very high quality growth. A lot of the South, for example, it's good on population, not particularly high quality growth. Now, there's a bunch of technical stuff here. I want to reassure you that these differences do not disappear when you correct them for housing costs. One of the things that people always said to us when we started this project is, oh yeah, the Bay Area looks richer, but you pay a lot more for housing up there. Actually, so yes, average housing prices are higher, But when you decompose them for different parts of the population and take into account what people pay for housing, Bay Area disposable income after housing retains about a 25% gap to Southern California at almost any population group. The other thing to know is these aren't differences because we're bigger than they are. If you rank the counties of the Bay Area in terms of per capita income, and you compare them to our county, our richest county, Orange County, it would rank seventh, I believe, in the Bay Area in terms of per capita income. It's seventh or eighth. So there are six or seven counties in the Bay Area that are richer than our richest county in terms of per capita income. It's a widespread failure in the entire Southern California region. We do have wealthy neighborhoods, but we don't have large tracts of wealthy places anymore, at least compared to the geographically spread prosperity of the San Francisco Bay Area. And the Bay Area has 75% of its population in counties that are richer than any of our counties. Now, how do you explain this? So there's an obvious story that anyone on the ground would tell. They would say, it's because the Bay Area has basically better, what we might call core industries. These are what are called the regional economic specialization of the two regions. The Bay Area in this period, it grows Silicon Valley, which is the world's high-tech capital. It refocuses its finance sector at the high end into investment banking. And it has the growth, a kind of indigenous growth of household corporate names coming out of the entrepreneurialism of Silicon Valley. All the, many of the names that we talk about are Fortune 100 companies that grow in this period from basically nothing in the Bay Area. Southern California is kind of the opposite. We lose a lot of our high-wage aerospace defense sector. We lose our corporate headquarters. We grow in light manufacturing, which is low wage. The one bright spot in our region is that the entertainment sector actually grows. I'll show you this in a second. We gain in transportation and logistics, but they're basically low and medium wage industries. And I'll show you as we are currently losing out in biotech. So our story just on the ground is not in any way an appealing story in terms of what does our region do. And our region actually it's highly diversified. That's what people like to say when they want to compliment it. I would call it unfocused. I'd say we're not actually excellent. We're not world class in anything in Southern California except Hollywood, which we are world class in. So here's the story in brief. This is taking just the employment in the core tradable industries. And the notable thing to look at here is that in information technology in 1970, the two regions have the same proportions. By 2010, what happens is that the proportion is four times higher in the Bay Area and exactly the same down here. So yes, we're big, therefore there's a fair amount of employment in it, but as a proportion of it, this core new economy tech sector is weak in our region and it becomes very strong. Now, for all of you students of urban economies, that's just looking at the direct core employment that we sliced very finely to give the most conservative estimate. We're not talking about all of the upstream and downstream effects of this. But 10% of a regional economy is really big if it's in the leading industry in the world. So if you measure just the wages in the core industries, and we could talk afterwards, or if you want to email me about the methodology for doing this, you can see a really sharp dividing line. These are the things that the regions, what are called exportable or tradable industries. There's just a huge difference in wages now. There's also a huge difference in innovation. Look at that. LA was a decent innovator up to through the 1980s. The Bay Area has something like 8 times more innovations, and it has set, I remember the number from the book, 6 times per capita more patents than we do. Now, here's what's also interesting about this. The differences in what our regions do is not just what we might call between the sectors. In other words, in the sense that the Bay Area has a lot of IT and we have less IT, or You know, we have more apparel manufacturer, they have less. So that was what we might call the composition of our core, of the core of our regional economy. It's also that when you look inside these sectors, it turns out that they're not the same in the two regions. By the way, if any of you are students doing research on regional economics, it is like saying apples and oranges to say we have high tech and they have high tech. In fact, internally, these aren't the same things. And here's how it shows up. Take some occupations. I just pulled out a sample of them. And these are really detailed. They're like slicing the jobs really finely. So you might think you're down to some, you know, some job that should be comparable in the two regions. And look at the wage differences, right? Look at them in 2000 and 2006. So San Francisco Bay Area wages for what are in principle the same jobs are dramatically higher than here. And what that's telling you is that these are not the same industries. So when I go down to Orange County, they tell me, yeah, we're a really huge IT complex. We're just like Silicon Valley. Nobody ever pays attention to us. The reason is that they're not like Silicon Valley. So they're really not doing the same things. That's what this is indicating. And there's a way to confirm this. So one of the really nifty things you can do if you're a wonky academic like me these days is you can take the work, you can take all the jobs and the industries in an economy, and you can strip them down to the kind of tasks that are accomplished in them with a fancy data transformation using stuff that people at MIT developed. Meaning, you can tell whether the jobs have principally cognitive content or manual content, and you can tell whether the jobs are routine and repetitive or non-routine and non-repetitive. And you can come up with a number for this. So what you can see here in the first column is San Francisco and LA and the United States. And we don't have to go into what the actual, like the 2-point whatever means. Just sort of use them in a comparison or benchmarking way. So the US is 2.40 in 1970. And both of our regions are above that line, meaning that's why they're rich in 1970, is more people here are doing cognitively based, non-routine work. And they're pretty similar, LA and San Francisco. But when you look over to the most recent period, we can measure it. And this is for all of the jobs in both regions and all of the jobs in the United States. So what you see is a general drift to the new economy, meaning the new economy has a higher proportion of jobs that are mental or cognitive and based on non-routine functions. So they all move up, but look at what happens. LA falls beneath the national average, and San Francisco opens up a greater gap to the national economy as a whole. This is this diverging fates of the two regions that I'm talking about. So how do we explain this, right? So the real issue is what happened? And I want to remind people that you could never have predicted this in 1970. And the reason is that Los Angeles County in particular, but Southern California in general, had the highest concentration of STEM workers, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, in the country and possibly in the world. We had the biggest and the biggest share of exactly the kind of people that you would think would be the people you need to be successful in the new economy. LA County, I believe, had more PhD engineers than anywhere in the United States. So going forward, we just said, where is the new economy that's so tech-based going to be? It's going to be down here. So we have a mystery here to explain what happened when the economy changed and why they win and we did. And San Francisco, remember, it was a highly educated region. It was a wealthy region back then, but it wasn't a particularly tech region. It was based on exploiting natural resources. It had a lot of corporate headquarters. It had a declining but still big port. It was kind of a cool place to live with a lot of wealthy people in it. But it certainly wasn't what you would have called a tech powerhouse of the middle of the 20th century. Southern California was. So something happened. So how do we explain this? Well, there's a lot of theories out there. And basically, you can think about two different kinds of ways of explaining it that come from sort of the economics in our field. One is, it says, and this comes from regional science and urban economics, the dominant sort of theory is if you have the right kind of people, then that will enable you to keep attracting the right kind of jobs. okay? And I'm simplifying what are very complex models and theories, but the basic emphasis is on getting your labor supply correct, and then that'll cause you to have the right kind of firms and entrepreneurship and industries. Here in what's called the new economic geography, that's a bit reversed. The emphasis is on getting the right kind of jobs, mostly getting the right kind of what we call clusters nowadays, and that those clusters will attract the right kind of people. Of course, in the real world, we know these things interact, but you're kind of looking at a case of like sharp divergence like this, you want to think about what threw the switch. Was it the people or was it the jobs? So, I want to spend just a second talking about this issue of the labor supply, which is the core, like I say, it's the core of the regional science theory about regional development. It's, in other words, it says, get the right kind of people and you will get the right kind of jobs. Okay, that's the key factor supply-based theory of development. Now, if it's driven by supply, you'd expect that a region with better specialization is gonna basically have more highly skilled people. So this is really current in everything from formal economics of the Harvard School, the Ed Glaser School, or the creative class theory, which is basically also about skilled people. You wanna bring them in, and then you think that your economic base is gonna follow the people somehow, and especially it's gonna make sure you do well in the next period of economic development. So the way if you wanna measure this, what you would look at is the composition of the labor supply and its skills in the region. And you would say that might explain why San Francisco does so much better. And at first glance, that looks pretty good because San Francisco has higher levels of education, more skilled people, and that widens the gap to LA over this period through different immigration. However, here's the problem. You would not expect the difference to come from people with the same types of skills getting paid differently in the two regions. In other words, I want to make sure people grasp the stakes in this argument. We might think that the Bay Area gets ahead of LA because more of its people have higher levels of education or skills. But we don't think that, say, if you take a person and you clone them, and you put that person in, say, in both regions, you would expect that individual to be rewarded similarly for her skills. But what we in fact find is that the majority of the difference comes from people with the same skills having increasingly different levels of rewards in the two regions. So I'll just kind of throw a few data things at you. This is college graduates. These are highly skilled people. They're paid similarly until the Great Divergence, and now they're not. How about immigrants? These are people foreign born. Notice that in the Bay Area, they have much higher wages. Part of that's because the foreign born people aren't the same ones. To put it bluntly, it's dominated by Asians with higher average levels of education. It's dominated by Latinos down here with lower levels. So part of it could be explained by that, except that turns out not to be true because when you pull the immigrant groups apart by education levels, so that would be, I don't want to offend anyone's, you know, political sensibilities here, but your typical case here was if you cloned one of the highly educated Asian immigrants, you put them in the Bay Area, they're going to make more money than their clone down here. So that's not Asian versus Latino, that's two Asians. But it would also be the same thing for a Latino with a college degree. They will do better up there. This is in fact true for the entire Latino population. The average Latino, and by the way, our book breaks it down by age, gender, and national origin, is they're gonna do better in the Bay Area than here. So any way you slice the labor market, within the categories, people are doing better. Occupations are more highly paid, and skills are more highly rewarded in the Bay Area. So what this means is that supply alone is differences, and they do exist. There are now more college graduates in the Bay Area. There's a higher proportion of Asian immigrants, and so on. But supply alone, the composition, the proportions, doesn't explain the difference. It's that within any of these groups, you do a lot better in the Bay Area. So What I take that to be, and in the book we calculate the actual proportions, and what we come up with is a bottom line. About one third of the per capita difference can be explained by the fact that the composition of people is different. More college education and more highly skilled immigrants up there. But two thirds of it is these differences within each of the groups. And that does not fit comfortably with the dominant theory about attracting skilled people or creative workers as the key to economic development. What it suggests is it's what happens to them. It's the kind of opportunities that happen when they arrive in a region, and the opportunities have widened. The opportunity gap between our region, whether you're low-skilled, high-skilled, highly educated, less educated, whether you're male or female, whether you're Latino or Asian, whether you're American or whatever, that there is now a structural demand or opportunity gap between our two regions. It's what we in geography would call the regional effect. So how do we explain that then? That changes the question. It refocuses us on explaining those changes in the core industries. Why did the Bay Area capture these industries and the new economy, and we didn't capture them down here? So what we did in the book is we constructed a lot of detailed histories of core industries like aerospace, IT, entertainment, finance, logistics and trade, biotech. And what we found is a complex story, but I think it's a pretty compelling one, that there are just different ways that firms, business leaders, leadership groups, and public agencies used the people and the technology in the two regions. Basically, they put all the ingredients into the pot in the Bay Area and they cooked it the right way. And we had some of those ingredients, but we didn't know what to do with them. And that's what I want to explain to you. So first of all, we focused on the who. We tried to look at what we call, and the fancy term for this is institutions, meaning how do government and non-government, civil society, organizations and networks, how did they influence the ways that the resources of the two regional economies were used, faced with an economy that had changed the way it does things? So we looked at formal institutions like governments, but more importantly, we looked at what we might call attitudes and networks in the entire regional economies. Formally, I want to just say something that might shock people here. We tried to measure what local and regional governments did to steer their economies in these two periods. The first thing is, I can tell you, many of you, if you study cities, you'll know this, there are no databases on it. You actually can't find out in any systematic and comparable way what all these hundreds of cities and counties do, what they spend on it, and what the impacts are. You can do it for a few big programs like Alameda Corridor, but you can't find anything about the day-to-day small little actions that affect things sort of on an ongoing way. We tried to construct a database and we ran into really unbelievable problems when you see how these government agencies, how they describe what they do, how they report it, whether they put it online or not. Basically, you're in a complete, you're like in a dark hole. So that's a real problem. We did a few things. Failing that, we analyzed public budgets to see if there were really systematic differences. The main one that we came up with is that the Bay Area spends more on culture and transportation, and we spend more on policing down here. But it wasn't big enough to explain this huge divergence in our economies. Well, and of course, what we found is this huge fiscal capacity gap that opened up. At the beginning of the period, all of our cities and counties taken together had roughly similar ability to spend on public goods. Nowadays, there's about a 30% difference that almost exactly tracks the per capita income difference. So the really scary part of that is not only is the Bay Area richer, but they can invest more in themselves to stay richer than us. These are like two gaps that track each other. But what we really turned to, and here's where the smoking gun came, sort of like we started to see, this is what's going on in the difference between these two regions, is we started looking at something very soft, which is how did the leaders of the regions see themselves? What were their worldviews? What were their beliefs? Now, I know this can sound flaky to hardcore economists, but I want to remind hardcore economists that Douglas North got a Nobel Prize in economics for saying that beliefs have a recursive relationship to economic development. We took him seriously on that. So we analyzed 30 years of reports from many of the major economic development agencies in the two regions, like ABAGS, Association of Bay Area Governments, SCAG, the Bay Area Council, the LA Business Roundtable, and a whole host of others, and my co-authors, and when they were way back then, when they were my graduate students, got tortured doing this stuff, but I think to a good end. So, you know, it's very hard to do content analysis, but we thoroughly analyzed what these different agencies said about their economies and their problems. And we found an absolutely striking difference. From the early 1980s, the Bay Area starts saying, we are an expensive economy with high factor costs, high land costs, high labor costs, and the only way we can survive is by transitioning out of manufacturing and becoming a knowledge-based region. Basically, what happens down here is, until literally a year or two ago, it's hardly ever talked about. That is, not in the 80s at all. In the 90s, we found two SCAG reports with brief mentions of it, but the dominant discourse here in Southern California is what I would call backward looking. It's about, let's lower our costs, let's get our land costs down, let's get our regulation costs are too high, we need to cut our red tape, and that somehow if we do that, and if we release land back into manufacturing here in central LA, that the golden days of being a huge manufacturing center will return. And essentially, and of course then they're crowded out also by events, a real estate crash in the 80s, civil disturbances in the 90s, an earthquake and things like that. And they basically never get it. They never say, we are an expensive region. The only way an expensive region survives in the new economy is by moving up the ladder of the economy into skilled functions that can pay high wages and tolerate high land costs. That's the structural logic of being a rich region. It never happens down here. Simply doesn't happen. Now, and what they do is they pull out a few what I would call well-meaning attempts to capitalize on our resources, notably that they go for the port. They go for the port in the logistics industry. We do have a successful program of building Alameda Corridor. We win. We become the West Coast port that gets the China trade. And I can't criticize that. I think that was a timely response to globalization. The problem is that it crowded out attention to other things, meaning it's what the Greeks in their tragedies called a Pyrrhic victory. You win, but you lose. And in the sense that everyone was so excited by our victory in this that they failed to see that port and logistics functions are low to medium wage. You'll win, but you're not going to be a high-income region by specializing in them. No region that specializes in them is. So it had a kind of a strange effect, and it sucked up all the air. Now, the Bay Area, like I say, the Bay Area also had not only the Association of Bay Area Governments, but they had something we don't have down here. They had a very dynamic, comprehensive private industry leadership group called the Bay Area Council. And not only did ABAG start talking about the new economy and all that, but especially the Bay Area Council Economic Institute, they started issuing one high quality report after another, analyzing the challenges to the Bay Area of being basically at the top of the world knowledge economy. So that now, we thought, okay, that's interesting when we pick up through a content analysis of all these, we pick up differences in discourses, but can we be sure that that's really a difference between the two regions? And so we decided to do a second step in this, which is we wanted to see how well networked are all those organizations into their respective regional economies. That is, do they have traction in the sense of really speaking to wide constituencies? So we did a quantitative analysis of the leadership of major firms, of major foundations, and major community organizations in the two regions. This is a technique that was now used in economic sociology, where you look at how people connect to one another by whether they're on the same boards of directors and how many, for example, it's like that old thing of how many people do you need to know someone else? That's called in-betweenness. It's another wonky thing. Anyway, I want you to look at the next two slides, because what this does is it takes the largest corporations in the two regions and it shows the leadership structures, that is the degree of connectedness between the major CEOs and boards of director members in the two regions. And all you have to do is eyeball it and you'll see the difference, okay? That's that's San Francisco, LA, right? There it is, connected region, comprehensive leadership coalitions, fragmented region. And with more detail, I could tell you that LAs have become more fragmented. And moreover, the fragmentation is not just because we have more industries here. It's that if you look inside the high-tech industry, what you find is that our high-tech industry is more fragmented than their high-tech industry, and so on and so forth. Okay, and so this shows the numbers. This is the role of the Bay Area Council is it has three times more average connectedness to business leaderships than the top leadership organization in our region. And moreover, after the top one, there's nothing here. Whereas in the Bay Area, there are three other organizations that are as effective as our top region. And there's a lot more numbers to back this up. This goes on and on. And basically, what we show is that innovation networks are denser there. People have worked with each other more. They have what we call invisible colleges. It's the kind of knowing someone else who's done something. I'm going to skip out. Same thing is true for people who create firms, entrepreneur networks. And the same thing is true for what we might call civil society. The density of labor unions, community organizations, philanthropic organizations is two times higher on a there's two times more of them in terms of assets, four times higher on a per capita basis in the Bay Area. That's it. So all of that is just kind of confirming that what we call the relational infrastructure of our two regions is dramatically different. And in times of change, what happens is the relational infrastructure of our region failed to take our assets and recombine them in a way that the new economy functioned. And they were good enough in the Bay Area to do that. And I want to finish by telling you two stories, okay? Do I have 5 minutes? No? He's saying, yeah, he's being polite to me. All right. And the stories are IT and biotech. I want to tell you how this happened. Like I said, LA had amazing endowments in semiconductor design and manufacture from the defense industry in the 50s and 60s. What happened is that, now the Bay Area also had pretty good forerunners to IT. Notably, it had Hewlett-Packard that existed. It was a garage-based firm from 1938 onward. They made a lot of communications equipment. LA was very good in communications because we had to guide all those satellites and missiles. So we were really good at that. And you needed fancy semiconductors to do it. What happened, of course, is that Fairchild, Hewlett-Packard, and Xerox, who are the early players in the semiconductor industry, they went down a different road from our defense-based companies. That's a pretty obvious shot, because if you're a big defense-based companies, you have these huge contracts on the Pentagon, and why would you want to go sell things to ordinary people? But how did it actually happen? That sort of explains why LA's firms were rigid. It doesn't explain why the Bay Area's firms that were smaller and more dispersed than ours, how they got the idea, how they came together and invented the new economy ecosystem. And what basically happened is that the Bay Area's networks all came together where different kinds of people talked to one another. That sounds like a strange theory of economic development. But it specifically happened at a place called Xerox Palo Alto Research Center. And one of the people who worked there, Paul Duguid, who's a professor at Berkeley now, he said, the strange thing about Xerox Park is it mixed hippie academics and buzzcut engineers. Now, we had a lot of buzzcut engineers down here in the defense industry. The difference is that they never actually got out. No one ever talked to them from outside of their world and said, there's a new world out there, and the world is what you might call technology applied to solving daily life problems, not just to making missiles and big systems. And what is and why did the Bay Area do that? Well, you can find out why by YouTubing Steve Jobs' Stanford commencement address in 2005 and going to the last 2 minutes of the YouTube. And at the end of it, he says, let me tell you what the real key to the early technology industry in the Bay Area was and that differentiated us from everywhere else in the country, including New York and Boston and Southern California. It's that we had a Bible, and the Bible was called the Whole Earth Catalog. Whole Earth Catalog was the Bible of the Bay Area appropriate technology movement in the 1960s and 1970s. And the idea was that we needed a revolution in daily life and technology. And it inspired, and Steve Jobs says, this inspired me. Paul Duguid said it, and many of the people who were present said, we did that. Now, you had kind of these people saying this off in Berkeley and Marin County and San Francisco, and you've got another thing going on with the engineers down in Palo Alto. The key thing that happened is Xerox brought them together and made them talk to one another. We had those people down here. No one ever talked to one another. Or I'm giving you what is a vernacular version of what's called the economic sociology network theory of economic development. That it's about, at times of change, what is critical is whether different kinds of ideas are brought together to change the organizations and ecosystems of production. And okay, last point. I really will finish on this. But this story is not a one-off. It turns out to be a repeating story in our two regions. And that you can see this in the recent history of biotech. So biotech is invented both in Southern California and in Northern California. It's invented with UCSF, University of California at San Francisco Medical Center in San Francisco. And it's also invented at the City of Hope Hospital in Duarte. Stanley Boyer, he comes from UCSF, and he actually thought the conditions for making it into a commercial industry were more propitious down here in Southern California. And so he came down here and did some of his first startups, him and his partner, down here in LA. And among them is Amgen. So Amgen is the first big biotech firm in the world, and he creates a board that is shared between people coming from Caltech, UCLA, and UCSB. And they triangulate. They locate Amgen in the midpoint in Thousand Oaks in the western San Fernando Valley. It's a strange decision. Amgen quickly becomes the most successful biotech firm in the world in the early 1980s. But by 1983, what happens is that Amgen has an initial public offering. It gets financing from big investors. And the first thing that happens is that they kick the scientists out of the management of Amgen. So Amgen becomes a very conventional, large-scale firm, and it is still one of the most successful biotech firms in the world. Boyer goes back to the Bay Area. He teams up with a young entrepreneur and venture capitalist from the IT world, and he starts a new kind of firm called Genentech, because he says, I created this thing in Southern California, but it's not any fun anymore. And the reason it's not any fun is it's just another big corporate firm. I'm going to go back to the Bay Area, and Genentech, he says explicitly, we're keeping the scientists on the board of directors. Scientists will be part of management. Scientists will have complete freedom to innovate and continue publishing academically. Oh my God, okay. And what happens is that he starts the spin-off model again. So that, here's the story, the Bay Area ends up with a cluster, we end up with a standalone firm. And that's the point, it's the repeating cycle of our two regions. We have old-fashioned 20th century capitalism down here based on big firms. They have ecosystemic, entrepreneurial, venture capital-driven, extremely innovative capitalism up there. So that's the story, it's not about your endowments, it's how you put them together. And the end of this is, what do we need to do? We need to change the conversation down here. The good news is, I think it's starting to change. I talked too long, but thanks very much for listening to me.
So much to say, so little time. Professor Currid-Halkett?
I'm just going to start by saying this is a tremendous honor for me. When I started my PhD at Columbia University, one of my first conversations was with Elliot Sklar, who was running the program at the time. And Elliot said to me, but what if it doesn't matter? What if we don't, none of the things that we do in economic development matter and we can't change things? Why are we studying this? And that was quite an existential start to my doctoral career. But at any rate, I did continue on. And in my first doctoral seminar, we read Max Weber, Anthony Giddens, Karl Marx, Amartya Sen, and Michael Storper. So just to give you a sense of the giants in which Michael's work resides with, Michael is a terrific scholar, and this book is fantastic, and it's gotten a lot of traction in the public world and major newspapers and magazines. I think it is, without question, Michael is a true public intellectual. And I think one of the really interesting things about listening to Michael speak is that there's extraordinary substance and rigor to the work, and yet he is able to tell you in plain English. And that is very powerful, and it is something most people can't do. But if you can learn it, it's a great thing. So I think listening to more of what Michael does would be good for all of us. I think getting back to this earlier conversation that I had with Elliot Sklar at Columbia, 15 years ago, I think this gets to a larger question that we all tackle as scholars within the area of economic development. First of all, what do we mean by economic development? But I think more exciting and problematic at the same time is, why does it change all the time? And why do some places that are thriving in one moment, and you can literally cannot imagine them being anything other than that, Pittsburgh, Cleveland, Detroit, Boston, then fade away? And why do some places seem resilient decade after decade, like New York, which had a hiccup in the 70s and, you know, is back on form? Michael tries to answer this question using LA and San Francisco to get at these larger questions. He calls it divergence, uneven economic development. He looks at really the natural experiment of San Francisco and Los Angeles. And he looks at a couple of things I think are really interesting. Perception versus reality. One of the things in reading Michael's work and hearing him speak that's very interesting is we do have this idea, and I think it's the media, that LA is really on top of it. The creative class is moving and leaving New York, it's going straight to LA. Hollywood drives the whole city, it probably does. But actually, when you look at the numbers, LA is not doing as well as it ought to be. And certainly given its history. So that perception versus reality was a real wake up for me. And I think what we're really trying to get to in Michael's work is, what is the truth? And is there a truth? Is there, to use Michael's term, a smoking gun? And he looks at population. Okay, so is it actually population growth? Is it income levels? Is it a combination of both? Is it industry? Is it industry specialization? And he starts to, and then is it not just population, but is it the composition? Is it immigrants? Is it particular kinds of immigrants? And the extraordinary rigor of unpacking that is something else. I mean, each one of those questions could be its own book, and yet you managed to fit it all in one. And the answer is no, it's not that. No, it's not that. And this counterfactual that the same, you know, immigrant, if they were in San Francisco or Los Angeles, would have a wildly different economic and social outcome, is fascinating. And what he concludes with is complicated economic development. It doesn't make our jobs easier as scholars or practitioners, but it does give us a bit of an answer, that we're dealing with different institutional milieu. I will use a sociology term. I believe we're dealing with different habitats. And that there is a way in which we talk about economic development and the economy in Los Angeles that is different from San Francisco, and that this becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And in fact, there's a myopia on both sides, and actually that's something that's really interesting thinking about San Francisco. They were onto it very early, but is it at the detriment to everyone else who's not a part of it? And Los Angeles wasn't and is now, you know, trying to catch up. And so you know, I'm just going to conclude here because I want to give you a chance to answer to ask questions. I love the work on social networks. I think it is fascinating. And I think the thing to really, my takeaway is that culture matters and social matters. There are dominant ideologies, and in San Francisco, and those of us who know some of the work done in Silicon Valley versus Route 128 know that this idea of a belief in connectivity and a belief in the work, not the firm, drove much of the innovation success in Northern California. This does make economic development difficult. It makes it complicated, and it also makes it unconventional. And this is a problem in some ways for us. It's not very straightforward how we use these nebulous concepts like the milieu. How do you change a culture in some sort of macro way, even if that is in fact the answer? How do we do that as policymakers? And what it really made me think a lot about was Alfred Marshall's work when he commented over 100 years ago on something in the air. And it turns out, over 100 years later, we are not necessarily talking about factories in Northern England, but we are still talking about something in the air. And I think what Michael does is he provides a little bit of what that something in the air is and really gives us some substantial data and evidence as to what that is and how we might apply that to really change the economic development fortunes of our cities. So thank you very much.
Tell me if I'm misunderstanding something. You spoke that it was the failure of LA to maybe foresee this new economy as well as San Francisco did and accommodate higher wage industries and occupations. My question is, like, is it the worst thing from a state perspective that maybe one region actually has more opportunity for low-income workers and one different key region has more opportunities for high-income workers, because if LA had followed San Francisco's path, would we not just have two huge regions with high incomes and less opportunity for low-income workers? I understand the failure, foreseeing the new economy, but in terms of the diversity of the state and opportunity for all sorts of people, is it a failure?
Yeah, okay, so let me give you, there's a few facts I didn't have time to cite. The first one has to do with income inequality in the two regions. Turns out that the Bay Area and LA have almost identical levels of income inequality, or what are known as Gini coefficients. They are both very highly unequal by developed world standards. Well, most big metropolitan regions today in the early 21st century have high levels of inequality. So about, for the people who know this stuff, about 0.5152. That's high. New York has the same level. London has the same level. Paris has the same level. That's because of their economy. So the difference between the Bay Area and LA is not that everyone at the top in the Bay Area is getting all the income. It's that at any level in the distribution, whether you're at the 10th percentile or in the median or in the upper, you are on average having a much higher real income in the Bay Area. So that is to dispel one myth. LA is poor and unequal. I shouldn't say poor. LA is now a moderate income metropolitan area and highly unequal. The Bay Area is a very high income area and highly unequal. And so really what we're getting at is the quality of opportunity. And that was the point about where I tried to say the difference between these two regions is not driven by their differences in supply. It is driven by what happens to people when they arrive in the region. And the problem with LA is that we are offering poor quality opportunities relative to the national economy, and the Bay Area is offering high quality opportunities. So what I'm saying is, I think my answer to your question is no. There should be room in an advanced economy should not be based on offering poor opportunities. That's what's called a mercantilist theory of economic development. A robust theory of economic development holds that you should be able to raise productivity and wages in every function that the economy does, even though you will always have some level of inequality. So no, we're failing. And we're failing, actually, for exactly those populations that need it most.
So my question pertains more to how possible spillover of industrial jobs and warehousing and distribution jobs could possibly impact MSAs like Phoenix or Las Vegas. On one of your charts, you showed that the population growth in Las Vegas was exponentially higher and wage growth was essentially negligible. So do you think it's only a matter of time until outside of the port jobs that a lot of our distribution and warehousing jobs get essentially relocated towards these MSAs with cheaper cost of human capital?
That's one thing we do have, is a really good geographical advantage of being close to our huge port where the goods come in. So it's possible, but what I would say in any case is that staking your economic development on the logistics industry is not going to get you very far in terms of economic development these days, and especially in a huge metropolitan region here with a high cost base, and a high cost base that can't be compressed by any public policy. It's just, we're big, we're now maturing, and we can never go back to that low cost base. So basically what you need to do is think about this in terms of what we might call development clubs. Las Vegas is a relatively low wage region. Las Vegas's next step is to move into what we might call middle wage economic functions. That's the next step on the ladder. And it would probably actually be, it would be the right thing in the medium run for us to start shedding some of those functions, insofar as we can replace them by being better in the high wage functions that we are structurally more adapted to. But we have a lot of work to make that happen.
So there have been a number of policies that have been thrown out there to increase minimum wage to $15 and $20 for the whole state. Can you just discuss the possible either positive or negative implications on how it can impact Los Angeles or San Francisco or both markets?
I know that there are, my colleague at UCLA, Ed Lehmer, has been doing a lot of work for Mayor Garcetti's commission on that, but I actually haven't read the results of the model. You know, you really have to get into those kind of fine decompositions to give good results, so I don't feel qualified.
Have you done any research on the issue of lack of diversity being a result of this in the Bay Area? I'm from the Bay Area, I grew up there. It was a very different place than it is today. It's very, very tech heavy for a lot of us. And I'm just wondering if one of the things you say when you look at Los Angeles, we think we're diverse, we're really not that diverse. Bay Area does not feel diverse in terms of its economy right now. That's just a sort of anecdotal perception, but I worry about the future. I'll be too heavily dependent on that, so if that's something.
And so we'll toss the last question in together with that.
Okay, my question would be a different scale of analysis. If you can compare this kind of institutional environment to other cities like São Paulo and Rio, or Melbourne and Sydney, Tokyo and Singapore, and this can help also to explain these changes.
The Bay Area and LA have both 38% foreign-born, identical proportions. The composition of the foreign-born is different, as I mentioned in doing the labor, referring to the labor supply analysis. Now, economic diversity is another question. You are absolutely right. LA is what I call diverse and unfocused in its economy because it doesn't have very many really clear points of dominance outside of Hollywood. The Bay Area economy is more focused and specialized. And of course, that's the question that people in the Bay Area, I think, are starting to ask right now is, are they becoming a one-horse town? And are they now invested in what is a maturing industry that might have the danger signs that we know exist from cases in the past? You know, at the point where Detroit was one of the richest, most entrepreneurial, powerful, glorious technological cities in America, 1960, was of course just at the point where, you know, it's over. And there are some signs that that's going on in the Bay Area, that it's locked into doing one thing. I don't have an answer to that. I think there are signs that it's still very creative, but it's not very diverse economically compared to what it used to be. Now, I think you are absolutely right about more paired comparisons. You know, like Rio Sao Paulo would be a super interesting one, or maybe even adding in Belo Horizonte. Montreal, Toronto, I have a graduate student in Europe, and we've been just starting on Paris and London. So we've crunched the numbers on Paris and London, and I think we're gonna do something interesting. But yes, the method is interesting, so long as you set up the controls on the cases in a way that you can really pull out what it is you want to look at. But I think it's an interesting way forward for the economic development field.
I want to thank Jess Jaworski for having pulled together this semester's work, and of course our speaker and discussant.